regular language you all know, and all the rules are closed. Well, that means they're closer. The most interesting rule is this homomorphism that yesterday I have discussed in my class. What is homomorphism? A string homomorphism is a function of a string that works by substituting a particular string for each symbol I have mentioned. So this is, I have taken the definition from John Hopcroft Ullman's book. This book is available with you as a soft copy and hard copy. So you follow that book, and this is there, that is a homomorphism. So homomorphism, it means you are replacing the input alphabet sigma with the other symbols. So all languages are closed under the regular context free language, context sensitive language, type 0 language. We know type 0 have two types of language. Type 0, one language which is easier, that is called Turing decidable or recursive language. The two names there, you follow the Michael Sipse's book, and the outer layer is Turing recognizable and recursively enumerable language. You can read a big name. That means that language is difficult, and all these languages compilation is exponential time. It will unbounded time. Still in context free, you know only n cube, regular grammar n, o n, n is number of terminals, o n cube, but by techniques, various rules techniques, we can make it o n. Otherwise you cannot write programs. If your programs takes n cube time, it is illogical. So that our programming languages all are deterministic, context free, and I have repeatedly told you it must be unambiguous grammar. And it is not certain that a deterministic context free grammar has always an unambiguous grammar. It is not, but chances are very high. You have to find it that way, get it unambiguous grammar, and there is no such algorithm. That I have told yesterday class also, that these are basically undecidable problems. First example of undecidable problem is Turing halting problem. And these are all undecidable problems. You have to search for it. So all programming languages, 99% of these constructs for deterministic context free grammar with deterministic context free language with unambiguous grammar. But you might ask whether the a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, or ww like context sensitive features is there or not. Yes, it can be, because in any programming language, a powerful programming language, because the more and more programming has become more powerful, it is away from the hardware, like our Python and all this, there might be some constructs with some features of context sensitive grammar, like type 1 language. So that particular one or two statements, a little amount extra time, because we have some so powerful CPUs. So that you always say. Anyway, this language is very interesting. So union of two regular languages is regular, that you know, intersection of two regular languages is regular. That cannot be said of context free language. You know, that is not hold true for context free languages, intersection of two. But you must practice. So what I wish to tell you, that you try to take this kind of topic in your presentation, this presentation or subsequent another presentation is desirable from you. So take this as a problem and give some examples from the regular language, context free language, because you know the context free language basically is two languages together. It's one is deterministic context free and non-deterministic context free. They behave differently. Complement of a context free, deterministic context free is a deterministic context free, but complement of context free is not necessarily context free. So they behave differently. So lot of ambiguity is there in context free grammar, because you know deterministic context free, even within deterministic context free we have several sales at unambiguous grammar, whether you can find a grammar at all or not. Yes, it can be possible that you cannot find a unambiguous grammar. So that's it. And then also subdivision, that I have told you that which grammar which can be top down parsing, like LL0, and which one as LR0. Zero is look ahead. Zero look ahead is basically very unuseful, that zero look ahead, it doesn't give you power. So you must see one look ahead. Like you just see, what is one look ahead? When you are taking the input stream, you see only the one look ahead and see the top of the stack and do the corresponding action. So one look ahead is give immense powerful than say LL1, that means top down parsing with left hand derivation. So with one look ahead is much more powerful than LL0, and LR1 is much more powerful than LL1. That means we are trying to get the rules from the right hand side and try to reach the A starting symbol by utilizing the rules by kind of a handle that I have already given example. So these are very interesting. In this context free grammar whole area is interesting. Then we will proceed to Turing, that I already covered certain things about it. That one great advantage of Turing machine is that anything you can write in any algorithm form, it can be done in Turing machine. That is, you see the genius of Alan Turing, say, in when at that time no push down automata is formally there, but I believe that Alan Turing does have the concept all. He goes ahead and develop Turing machine and to compute all the problem. It's a theoretical machine, but it can, if you can write an algorithm, it can be done Turing machine. Okay. So this basic things today, basically I wish to cover the pumping lemma of context-free grammar. In my regular language, you always see the pumping lemma 1 and pumping lemma 2. The people generally talk that way. Pumping lemma 1 means pumping lemma, you can pump at only one place or at two place, but no synchronization. That is pumping lemma 1 and pumping lemma 1 for regular languages. That is a test for the if a particular language fails pumping lemma 1, that language cannot be regular language. Okay, but that doesn't mean that if a language follows pumping lemma 1, that is not necessary and sufficient condition, that not sufficient for regular language. So this, how to get examples, a language which obeys pumping lemma 1 but not regular language, I try to give example, and but it is difficult. So that is the pumping lemma 1, and we will go in details of the pumping lemma 1 and how to prove it, and then there comes the pumping lemma 2. That is difficult, that is explaining is difficult. I am trying my own way. You please follow the Hopcroft-Toulmin book and Sipsa's book. Both have gone to extent very well. The pumping lemma 2 is that you can pump at two places, and they define difference may be another string which is not pumped, and this string may go to epsilon. So the pumping can be a to the power n, b to the power n. So pumping both places, or I have a string said here we have given examples UVW XYZ, maybe there W is there, W may go to epsilon, X and Y can be pumped. Okay, so this thing, so like a to the power n c b to the power n, or a to the power n c to the power m b to the power n, because I am pumping c, but this pumping doesn't have any synchronization with anyone. But whenever I am pumping at two different places, like a to the power n c b to the power 2n, there is some synchronicity there, a to the power n and b to the power n. That is a sign of a context free grammar, context-free languages. I am not saying the deterministic or non-deterministic, that's true for context-free grammar. And if any language fails this, like famous example is a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, or a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n, d to the power n, all are context-sensitive grammar, because you are pumping at three places with synchronicity, or four places. These are all context-sensitive grammar. We know, we discussed yesterday, the context sensitive grammars can be, any context sensitive grammar can be converted to Kudos form, that form that is like Chomsky's normal form, left hand side is single variable, right hand side two variable, or left hand side is single variable, right hand side is terminal, like Chomsky's normal form is context free grammar, and another third rule is left hand side two variables, right hand side two variables only, not that. So this form, that is one kind of normal form. Why this kind of normal form? Because even if any programming languages incorporates a little bit of context sensitive grammar, the rules to the parser, remember that if this parser is generated by another program itself, that programs is called yet another compiler, there's Bison, there's a programs, standard programs are available. So you generate parser, and what are the input of this black box? The program generator, you input the rules of your programming languages in Baka's normal form, that I have explained in one of the classes, how you can express your programming language rule in Baka's normal form. You input this and you will get the parser output, and this parser is basically your you can run it at your machine. So every like Unix and any other open system, and even it is other system also in open system environment, these are tools are available. So you can generate a parser and this thing. So where we are, that is I am telling the what is the role of context sensitive grammar, and and today we are discussing again the pumping lemma 1 and pumping lemma 2 in details. The to go into the pumping lemma 2, we should revisit the pumping lemma 1 and try to get it. The pumping means it pumping at one place, or at pumping maybe two place, but no connection between it. This is the pumping lemma 1, and this pumping comes this famous pigeonholes principle. What the pigeonhole principle says, that if you put four pigeons in three holes, at one pigeon must have two pigeons, one hole must have two pigeons. That is a obvious rule. So if you give an infinite language with some finite number of states, then it at must some states there may be a loops must be there. If you convert the pigeonhole principle to your FSM, which generates the infinite language with a finite number of states, how can you generate infinite language? Definitely there are some looping there within the states, it loops between the states. This is called one, this is a pumping is there. Okay, so I think you, any question you can ask me, because online class. Yeah, this is I am taking the exact definition from the this is the Hopcroft book. So you get it at the chapter. This is that is earlier, the closure of Legendre is under Boolean expression. So this is true. This is true for not only regular, it's the context free also, context sensitive also. Union is there. Union of the ALA name, the language of alphabet, ALU is regular. But here it is regular language, it is a regular language, but if it's a context free language, it is not a context free. So different. And the complement. Here also the complement, here regular language is a complement regular language, but the context free complement of a context free is not, may or may not be context free, but for a deterministic context free it is. So that's it. Yeah, this is the, I am taking the Hopcroft Ullman's book's definition of regular language. I always try to compare at least two books, Hopcroft, that is the international standard book, and Michael Sifser, both are international standard book. Another book I wish to give you that is Peter Lin's book. Unfortunately, Peter Lin's book soft copy is not available with me. If you can find it out, please send it to me. All other books soft copy is available. I have already sent it to you. These books are very good, and these are the standards. And you always see the what is the other way definition, and there's some subtle definition. You try to understand why they have the subtle definition. Then I'll give my preference. Go for this particular book, you go for this chapter. Like Turing machine, I found it best covered in Michael Sifser's book, but Hopcroft book is always one of the ultimate place. You can get all these things, but it little longer, you have to have patience to read it. Here, it is a pumping lemma for regular languages. Let L be a regular language. Then there exists a constant n. This, you will find it. In Sitzer, they just give it the name P. And I think that is more, you can remember that P for pumping length. And here, Hopcroft book, it is a n. So, that is only the difference. Then, such that for every string W, is its terminals in L, such that mod of W is greater than A. So, you have to choose a sufficient long string with N so that you can get the behavior of pumping. We can break W in three strings, W, X, Y, Z, Y not equal to epsilon, X, Y less than equal to pumping length, and so that you can, because why I am pumping here. If it is epsilon, it is trivially simple that it must be then regular language. So, that is the reason why can't be epsilon, then it will be no use at all. So, here the string is XYZ, I am pumping at Y place into L. That is, we can always find a non-empty string Y not too far from the beginning of the W that can be pumped, and that is repeating Y any number of times or deleting if it is good, keeps the resulting string in language L. So, this is the definition of pumping lemma 1 as per Hopcroft's book. Let's see how the definition comes to Sitzer's book. Yeah, Sitzer's book definition is very similar. Say it is said, see here, we go for S, okay, and pumping length is here P. If A is a regular language, then there is a number P. P, you can remember, it is P for pumping length, and Hopcroft, that is N. This is the same. If S is any string in A of length at least P, then S may be divided into three pieces. S is equal to X, Y, Z, satisfy the following condition. Like this. The same condition. If you look, there is just wordings a little bit different. So, you compare with Hopcroft books, so both the books are excellent. But Hopcroft book goes into very detail. I believe though you should read both, then you can converse in the various, and another books, Harris Demetriou, that both soft copy. Those three are the best books in international market. Yeah, then you can see the comparison. This is the comparison, Hopcroft Toulmin's book, and this is the Sitzer's book, Pumping Lemma. It is called pumping lemma. It is also pumping lemma. Only thing I have told you N, and it is a P. The only the, and wordings are different, more or less same. Maybe, yeah, it is here. Now it is come the pumping lemma for context. This is a pumping lemma context free languages. This is says. This is difficult. This is its string is jet, and here it is a you have to divide the string in five parts and constant here n as per Hopcroft's n, and we'll see in Sitzer's is a p, but you have to take a sufficient long string at least n mod j is accurate, and we can write j, that is, it is kind of challenge and response type, that is you have to divide it on your own and you have to prove it. So, nobody will divide for you. You take the string, you take the sufficient long string, and if you prove it that this part of the string not obeying this, then that is okay. That means you have to, that is your choice, but you have to take a sufficient long amount of string, not less than the recommended. So, here J is you divide it into three parts. Earlier we have three parts, here five parts. Yeah, it is five parts here. U, V, W, X, Y, and your pumping should be at V and X, and that is synchronized. So, the pumping would be at V and X, and W maybe epsilon. Again, W like A to the power N, B to the power N, W is epsilon. Okay, so V and X to be pumped, and but this should be finite, not infinite. So, I am pumping here, then after infinite, I will pumping there. Whether that is a context-free? No. This should be finite. they should be finite. Finite means it may be one character, 100 character, or 1000 character, but it should be finite. Okay, so terminals, sorry, it's 1000 terminals. So this is a, you have to see if it's 1000, then you have to choose around say 1010 your string. VWX less than equal, like same as pumping lemma 1, and this is same to be pumped, and you are pumping here. Then you can say that is a two string. Then you can say that is a it is defying pumping lemma 2, like a to the power n, b to the power n, c to the power n. It will defy. And another interesting case I will try to show you next class, or you can take it as a challenge, a WW language. These examples are given in the success book, and both books are there. You have to prove by the pumping lemma 2 that it is not obeying pumping lemma 2, so it cannot be a context free grammar. So you have to take the sufficient amount of string and show it. So that's it. Well, what I want to stress upon you, whenever you want to understand the pumping lemma 2, you go back pumping lemma 1 and see how to prove it. The same thing is done in pumping lemma 2. So read those pumping lemmas 2 together. Try to give an example. And another lemma is there that you can take it as a your presentation, Ogden's lemma. Ogden's lemma is a more stricter than pumping lemma 2 for declaring a language is not context-free language or might be a candidate for context-free language. I will discuss it some other day. That is called Ogden's lemma. So these are all lemmas. You know what is the difference between lemma and theorem. Lemma is basically a bit weaker than theorem, but basic solid groundings theorem are much stronger. Lemma is not that, but lemma is required to prove something. So you can call it little weaker than theorem. It's a mathematical convention that the computer scientists they have given this lemma, and this is theorem. Here it is the definition of the context-free language, pumping lemma 2 from the Michael Sixers. You see the same here. Fortunately, they have same in UV XYZ, and probably they have given W. I just check what they have given. Yeah, they have taken W, and Sixers book, it is X. So that's a little difference. No issue, but you are pumping at V, you are pumping at Y. Yeah, you're pumping at V and pumping at Y, and your length is P. Okay, like if you see the hop curve, it is pumping at V and pumping of X. And here the Sifse's book is little difference. That you can probably remember this very well, because they are alphabets are coming together, U, V, W, X, Y. Here you not W, so that is a bit confusing. If it's a W Sifse's, it is good. Okay, the any, but here P is more sounding like pumping length, but they are equivalent. You can in Hopcroft book that is a W, and here it is X, and these are the rules. It's obvious. This is a Michael Sifse's book. This I have covered this thing, and I think now I wish to cover little about, see here, yeah, it is Hopcroft books. This is pumping lemma 1, and this diagram is interesting. It is a, it must be looping activity there. It is the that this looping must be there, otherwise you cannot get infinite language. That is the pigeonhole principle, simple pigeonhole principle. Application of pumping lemma. This is pumping lemma as an adversarial game. That means it's a challenge and response. It is your job to find a sufficiently long string and prove it is not obeying the pumping lemma. So this is a very interesting statement. It is as a game test sort of thing, challenge and response, like player 1, player 2, and this. Please go details into the book, then you can understand very well. It is not so fierce. These things is very important, and by pumping lemma 1, you can prove this language is not obeying pumping lemma 1. You can do it. At least see one or two examples from the Hopcroft and Ullman. Okay, Hopcroft and Ullman, and this is very interesting. This is this language I have told in one class is 0 to the power n. The alphabet is only 0. Very interesting language, and to the power n is a perfect square. So which kind of grammar it can be, which kind of machine? Definitely Pushdown automata of no use, and Pushdown automata cannot get the idea of whether n is a perfect square or not. But I have shown you in by Turing machine whether n is perfect square or not. You can easily do it by Turing machine. You have to configure this machine that way. I have shown you 0 to the power 2 to n like this. Same way you can do it. 0 to the power n is a perfect cube. That is also solved by a Turing machine. This I have shown you. N is a power of 2 by Turing machine. So this sidewise, now we have knowledge of all the machines and see it. And closure properties I have discussed in regular language, but always remember the context free grammar difficult. Complement of context free is not context free. That I have covered. Why, what if the language of different alphabet, that is called homomorphism, that I have discussed. Yeah, and now Michael Sipse's book, this is pumping lemma 1. This is the looping activities goes. So diagram wise almost same. That is your pick, that is your looping must be there. These examples, see here, they have gone to whether how to prove WW is not a regular grammar. You can follow under the logic here and prove it. Okay, so because I have little bit of extra time, so we can visit one or two things today. That is, I go very detailed, particular this problem, Turing halting problem. This halting problem is a very interesting topic. This is the first problem, halting problem. It has been the first undecidable problem. Remember, in computer science, there are generally two types of problem. One is decidable problem or not. The answer will be yes or no, and answer will be yes or no. Another problem is optimization problem. So you want to get the circumference of Earth, you want to get the height of the Himalayas, whether it is a 28,298 feet or not, or 4,448 meters or not, whether 48.1 or 48.3, whether it is increasing, what is the earthquake Richter scale rating, whether 7.2, 7.3, or what is the amount of rain is falling. So whether 123 millimeter today. So these are all the optimization problem. You are try to measure it from the various data and try to figure it out. What is the numerical value? What is the what names are there? So it is a optimization problem. Though you find it, the optimization problem is interesting, but the most general problem is decision problem, whether yes or no. And by yes or no answer, probably you have already participated in game like Dumption or something. that whether the candidate has to say whether yes or no, by 20 question you can find it out what personality and what object the person is thinking about or not. So this is very, very powerful. So decision problems. So yes or no, that within the answers, binary yes or no, then you can solve any problem. So that is the, even in optimization problem also, you can solve. You can first question is whether the height of the Everest is more than 30,000 feet. Answer will be no. Whether then you ask whether the height of the Everest is more than 28,000 feet. Answer will be yes. Then you modify your questions. Then you pinpoint particular height. Yes, yes or no, yes or no, yes or no. Maybe at certain point you cannot, some uncertainty is there. That is always uncertainty will be there. So what I want to impress upon you, that decision problems, that whether the answer is yes or no, like you can think it at the final state machine, whether it is accept or not, same. Then in the Pushan automata, whether string is accept or not, how can you see the string accept? That your stack should be empty, your input reader should go at the rightmost, then there will be no input, your stack is empty, and your FSM should be in accept state. So that means machine has accepted. So accept yes or no, then Turing machine, you know, the machine accepts or rejects. How can you know that is your FSM, your FSM is a little bit modified than FSM and FSM used at FSM and PDA. Here you have extra state, that rejecting state, accept and reject. If any time the machine go to the reject state, then rejected. So it's again the decision problems. Except that million Moore machine, that is little bit away, that is, that machine is not giving decision problem. That machine say just give output. You know, the Moore machine always give extra, one bit extra, because Moore machine correspond to states. If you put n terminals there, it will be output will be n plus 1. Moore machine, Mealy machine is n, because Mealy machine output is transition, but it is not decision problem. Mealy machine and Moore machine is not giving decision problems. But what I want to impress upon you, that all other machines like your this finite state machine, your push-down machine, your Turing machine, they always give accept or reject. If his Turing machine is accept, then the your result is on the tape itself, because that is the powerfulness of the Turing machine. It writes your output like Moore machine or Mealy machine on the tape itself. But we are not bothered what is written on the tape if the machine is rejected here. So we only go to the see into the tape what is there, whether what output is written, then when it is accept. But if yes, yeah, sometimes we can go bother when the Turing machine halt, doesn't halt, and or doesn't accept, or accept, you want to see how the Turing machine comes to this. We can debug those written symbols by the Turing machine on your tape, that is help in debugging. I think we are in another 10 minutes. So we have that help you in debugging. So that is the essence of the problem. That is the one thing I always wonder at my younger days, probably, I don't know whether you are wonder at or not. You see the calculator. You see, in our time also, whenever I passed in from Jadavpur University, the calculator is very powerful. So Casio FX83, LCD powered, solar powered, all, not solar powered, our calculator available. It can calculate anything in a damn time. It's cube root and all this. Then, when I'm in computer science, you might think, if calculator is so powerful, then why you need a computer? Or why you need a, yes, computer, adapter, desktop. The calculator can do anything. It can do the Bessel function, whatever the function you have, Fourier transform now also, FFT and all things. And then what is the purpose of this computer then? A computer doesn't give a calculator that way under the Windows. So best problem is the calculator you cannot program. Maybe now the calculator available, you can have little bit program. The program is more powerful. That I want to impress upon you again and again, because these 1950s and 60s, when the computer is available to the advanced world like America, Japan, and European UK countries, then they are progressing like anything. They make revolutions in anything, in computer science. Even see America, still this more than 5 lakh state, it is progressing because they have the superiority in computer science. They all the computers, the Google, Microsoft, Oracle, all companies are there. So what the reason? Because they program. They have a machine, they have a programming language, they have a frameworks. So that is the reason. So the programming is a keyword, and programming can only be done if you know the deterministic context free grammar, unambiguous. So but your calculator doesn't have this. Your calculator have some pre-programmed unit are there, calculate square root, calculate this, but how to use these, then you need a language, then you need a parser, then you need a full-fledged computer. So that is the thing, that our laptop and desktop is more powerful, even probably our mobile computer also, if you can program, but that way desktop and laptop, so you have programming. So what I want to talk again and again, so basically in computer science, we want to find the answer yes or no, and sometimes it is not available. Answer is not yes or no, sometimes halting, not halting. That is, you given a question to a computer, a tuning machine, it doesn't halt. So if it halts, then it's your answer is yes or no, either of it. But it doesn't halt, it doesn't have any, you doesn't have a answer, and then you call the program is undecidable. So this is the first definition of undecidable problem by Turing halting problem. Given a sufficiently high level programming language L, it can take it as a example of Python or C, can a program Q be written on in L that will take for input for any program P written L together with a legal input X, yeah, for P, such that Q can determine if P will halt on input X or not. So answer is not. So that is a Turing halting problem. And what is the reason? It is a decision problem. 99% computer science problems are decision problems, not optimization problems. Maybe few in some your numerical solutions, you are exposed to optimization problems, but all optimization problems can be solved by a decision problem. How? You can give an example, you can give a hard limit, whether it is yes or no, and lower limit, yes or no, then you can get your answer to this problem. That is a optimization problem. That is a Turing halting problem. This is interesting. There are lots of other undecidable problems. So first remember it, whenever we teach the first class, one or two classes, I told you the algorithm is there. If you cannot find the algorithm, that is the first taste of undecidable problem. Here it is not, algorithm is not there. If it is algorithm is there, algorithm means it doesn't, it have loop, but it will some fixed state and it will come to an end. If the algorithm is not there, that's the first case, and the algorithm you have to measure the complexity. The complexity in the regular language is O(n) and deterministic context free grammar with some clever tricks will come to O(n), but generally O(n) cube. And then if you go context sensitive grammar, it will be 2 to the power something. That is complexity. That these problems are called, whenever n is at the base end, like n square, n cube, these are very easy problems. We call it a tractable problems. When n goes to the power, like our tar of Hanoi, 2 to the power n, or these we call intractable problems. So we have algorithm, but the complexity is intractable. But then another term is right term comes, that's undecidable. Then undecidable problems means it is related to decision problems mainly. Decision problems, I have explained to you what is decision problems, and most of the problems can be solved by a decision problem. And decision problems, whenever you do not have algorithm, then this kind of problem will be there, and there we can have some issues as NP complete problem, NP complete, what is NP problem, that is NP doesn't mean non-polynomial, no, it is not that, It is NP means non-deterministically Turing machine can solve it in polynomial time. Okay, that is full name of NP. P is polynomial problem. We know all this thing, and NP problem, NP complete problem, NP hard problem, we'll discuss in subsequent classes. Very interesting. You can see the chapter section 3 of Michael Sipse's book, what is the NP complete problem. That is, that will help you in your algorithm class. These as a computer scientist will be always interested in the that is the portion that is Turing decidable, Turing recognizable. Beyond that also many languages are there. Whenever we are speaking, it is a type 0 language, but the type 0 language is several layers. Two layers we have discussed, not very detailedly, that is Turing decidable and Turing recognizable. Beyond that is also there layer, and parser exists there. Whenever your Google or Microsoft Cortana, Google Hello, or Apple Siri, on Amazon, they can communicate with the users. They use this kind of algorithm for parsing the voice. They have a grammar. We have English have a grammar and all. It is good. The English has a grammar is typically go to the context-free and context-sensitive grammar, English language. But that cannot be said. I have told you the Bengali and Tamil. As far as I know, the most advanced language in India is the Tamil. It's the oldest language. Then you can some Bengali language also there. Sanskrit is there, but Tamil is very old language. Maybe as old as less older than Tamil, but Tamil is a very rich language. They are not obeying the rule of context-free grammar or context-sensitive grammar as per the Noam Chomsky's form. English language is that way a very suitable language for programming. So that is the reason, though English is not all over the world, it is not the populous language. Popular language maybe Chinese or maybe Spanish, English comes to maybe fourth and fifth and like this. But in programming, I have not heard any other programming languages other than English. So that is the strength of Unix. It's very simple. Alphabets is 26. That I like about it. If you go for Bengali alphabets, there is so many alphabets, hardly some of them are not used. Maybe Sanskrit also, that's very difficult, your alphabet. Here see, your input alphabet is 26 only, and meaningful sentences expression can be expressed. That is the first test, how many alphabets. See, if you go for the Chinese, the alphabets are many. Even the words comes to a picture, Chinese and Japanese. So then it's very complex. Okay, so with this, I am ending today. Next class will go more detailed about this halting problem, NP, NP complete, NP hard, and then we'll discuss some of the issues I have already covered in regular language, context free, Turing machine, universal Turing machine. I have given idea, universal Turing machine. Universal Turing machine means your code comes first. That code, after it reads the code, the machine configures itself. And then your data portion comes, machine reads the data and puts the data. Like all our current machines obeying this kind of universal Turing machine. Approximation to universal Turing machine, much more powerful. Yes, any question you can tell me. Thank you very much. Have a nice day. And give your attendance any question you can.